Praise the Lord, this is Bishop Manigault. Thank you for stopping by Bishop's Corner. I appreciate you stopping by for a few minutes. I want to share a word with you today from the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verses 1, probably through verse 3. This is what the word of the Lord says. After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites with some of the Midianites came to wage war against Jehoshaphat. Some people came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea. It is already in Hazan Tamar, that is, in Indigene." Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed the fast for all of Judah. In our scriptural lesson today, Jehoshaphat found out that a great multitude of people had gathered themselves in battle armor and in battle array, and these people on their way to do battle with him and the children of Israel. As a result of that, the Bible says that Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord. He also proclaimed the fast throughout all of Judah. There's nothing wrong with being afraid as long as you handle your fear in the proper manner. You see, my brothers and sisters, there are things going on right now that should cause us grave concerns. When you see the response to a virus that has ravaged the world becoming worse than the virus itself, we have cause to be afraid. When there are people raging and rioting in our streets in the name of justice and peace, even as feckless and corrupt leaders pretend that burning buildings and attacking innocent people are really just peaceful protests, we have good reason to be afraid. When you see people committing acts of violence that before now only the most hardened and deranged criminal would commit, we should be afraid. Be very afraid. When our people commit murder, infanticide, patricide, matricide, suicide, at all at rates that are unheard of and even unseen before in this country, we ought to be afraid for them and, quite frankly, afraid for ourselves. When our criminal justice system increasingly consistently provides no justice for those who lack sufficient influence or money, we ought to be afraid for the fate of all of those who become entangled in such a system as this. When our welfare systems have not helped us to fare well, but have helped us to become complacent, dependent, and without personal responsibility for our own well-being, we have just cause to fear. When standing up for what you believe in is considered an intolerant and unkind act, but living a life devoid of sound moral principles is considered a balanced, reasonable, and enlightened position, we have just cause to fear. You see, my brothers and sisters, we live in a world where they're calling wrong right, and they're calling right wrong. And as Dorothy told Toto after riding the whirlwind into Oz, "Hey Toto, I got a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore."
Toto? I have a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore.
In a world where men marry men and women marry women, I got a feeling that we're not in Kansas anymore. In a world where your sex or gender are not the same, I got a feeling that we're not in Kansas anymore. In a world where you can deny your biological gender and yet say you believe in science, I've got a feeling that we're not in Kansas anymore. And in a world where the killing of the unborn up to and through the ninth month is celebrated, called choice, and is praised as progress in the fight for women's reproductive rights, I got a feeling that we're not in Kansas anymore. When the number of people who won't work and don't work is on the increase, but have their food and their clothes and their shelter paid for by the people who do work, I got a feeling that we're not in Kansas anymore. When the number of people who won't work or don't work are taught to complain about the riches of the people who do work, I got a feeling that we're not in Kansas anymore. And finally, when we measure our good and our worth or our value to this world by our intentions or by our skin color or by our sexual orientation or by our political affiliation instead of by our character, Hey, Toto. I got a feeling we're not in Kansas anymore. Given all of this, there's no question that what we have to fear is more than just fear itself. The real question then is not whether or not we have anything to fear. The real question is, what do you do when you are anxious and afraid? What do you do? Do you pray and ask God for his help? Or do you just fret, worry, and cry and complain? I've come to remind somebody today, no matter what is going on, and despite of what is going wrong around us, God is still on the throne. You see, it makes no difference to him whether we're in Kansas or whether we're in Oz, because we may be outnumbered, but we will never be outdone. And as the wine said, God is the only thing right left in a very wrong world. In the text, Jehoshaphat did not allow his fear to make him lose his focus. The Lord would have me to remind you today, don't allow fear to cause you to lose your focus. Someone once defined fear with an acronym this way, F-E-A-R, fear, false evidence appearing real. Fear will make you think something is real when it isn't. It will cloud your judgment and it will mess with your mind. The Bible says that Jehoshaphat feared, but in the midst of his fear, he did something else. He set himself to seek the Lord. He proclaimed the fast. Somebody needs to get this. In the midst of your fear, there is something else that you can do. In the midst of your fear, there is something else that you can do. Don't let fear cause you to lose your focus. Set yourself to seek the Lord. Determine in your mind that despite my fear, I need to find out what God is going to do about this. Set yourself to seek the Lord. In other words, get yourself in a position to hear from God. You ought to pray like you've never prayed before when you are afraid. You ought to fast like you've never fasted before when you are afraid. And you ought to study the Word of God like you've never studied before when you are afraid. Open up God's Word. Get in it and let it get in you. Indeed, with all of the trouble that's going on around us, we should be constantly on our faces before God, fasting and praying continually. Praying is talking to God and allowing God to talk back to you. Fasting helps you to hear God over the demands of the flesh and helps you to submit yourself to his will. That is what Jehoshaphat did. We should also do the same. When you do this, this will put you in a position to hear from the Lord. And only then will we come to understand that with God, all things are possible, that there is nothing too hard for our God, and we may be outnumbered. With God on our side, we will never be outdone. Well, my time is up for today, but I do thank you for yours. Talk to you next time. May God bless and heaven smile upon you, is my prayer. Bye-bye.